Hello, it's Melody. Welcome to Saner Spin episode 22 this week. This week I want to address a question that I get possibly more than any other question, especially when I'm meeting with people, family members of other people with mental illness. And that is, how do I help my loved one, my friend, get help when that person doesn't know that they need it? Sometimes that's just somebody who has a friend who has a family member who's difficult, and they're trying to read mental illness on this person and they don't actually have one. They just happen to be somewhat of a jerk. And that's entirely possible, right? So there's that. But other times it's very legitimate. Somebody has a mental illness, they're off their meds. And off their meds, they might be off their meds for good reason, because their meds weren't working or the side effects were intolerable. So obviously that's another issue. And instead of going off their meds, it would have been obviously more responsible for them to consult with a psychiatrist on how to get to different meds. That can get expensive. And so, I mean, to understand where they're coming from in that case. But basically the question is, from often with a mother of an adult son. This is somebody who's an adult, who's not a minor, so you can't forcibly put them in the hospital in the way that you can with minors, which is also problematic sometimes. But regardless, what do you do if somebody is a threat to themselves or others? You definitely will call the police, but stop. Okay. If they're a threat to themselves or others, you can't ignore society. You can't ignore the rest of what is happening in the world around us. And I say this in light of two incidents in particular that I'm aware of just this past month, and there have been many more, of two young black males who were shot to death. One unarmed and naked, shot to death. Naked. Like, where is he holding? Where is his threat? I don't understand. But that, of course, has to do with racism in our society. And he was deemed a threat because of who he was and the color of his skin. No doubt that had to do with it. So sometimes it's easy, like, you're dealing with mental illness and you might just forget, like, oh, this is a really racist society we live in already. When I call the police officers, I also have to keep in mind that my son, my daughter, happens to be black, for example. And there was another instance of a young woman with bipolar disorder. She was also African-American, being killed. And that was maybe a couple months ago. I think her name was Tanisha Anderson. She was killed, thrown to the ground, and killed. So these stories show us that you can't escape other societal problems. You can't escape racism, you can't escape misogyny, and you can't escape all that other stuff and be like, oh, I'm just going to deal with mental illness. No, you need to acknowledge all of those things. So if you're calling the police officer and you happen to be calling a police officer when you have a son who is young and black and big, be careful. Be especially careful. You shouldn't have to be. Obviously, you shouldn't have to be, but be especially careful and cautious about calling the police, because they may kill your son. That said, and I don't say that lightly at all. It's important. I wish we didn't have to consider it, but you have to consider it no matter what race or background you belong to, but even more so if you're a young black male, and that is just the world, unfortunately, that we live in. So if you call the cops, so if you do, if you think you have to do this, what you're going to do is you're going to call and say, I need a crisis intervention team to come, and they might not have one, in which case, please, for the love of God, work to get one in your community as much as you can, and we need more of them. I'm hoping that they become mandatory. These are teams that are trained in mental health emergencies, and I think all police officers need to be trained in mental health emergencies, because there are ways to de-escalate the situation that don't include killing somebody or maiming them or otherwise injuring them. At all. They're very effective ways that they're just not properly trained in that. And as a lawyer, I will tell you that a lot of law enforcement officers don't actually know the law. Like, they'll know the city ordinance, for example, but they don't know the fact that this city ordinance, it does, like, just because that you have a city ordinance where you live, that's great. If your city ordinance violates the Constitution of the United States, that's not a valid city ordinance. And you don't want to fight to the death to defend your city ordinance, or anything else that is in violation of the Constitution. So, point being, don't expect law enforcement officers to actually know the law. Unfortunately, they don't always. That said, who do you contact? So, before you're going to contact the cops, of course, that's a situation that you're going to do only if there's a mental health emergency and you want to ask for a crisis intervention team, if there's a mobile crisis team, you can call the National Suicide Prevention Lifeline and ask them about resources in your area. Ask them about what they suggest to do. Tell them you're concerned about certain issues, for example, and they can direct you to local resources. They're incredibly helpful. I've called them before. There's also a chat. Their number is 1-800-273-8255. I'll write it at the bottom, and it's 1-800-273-TALK. They're a great resource. And like I said, again, the National Alliance on Mental Illness and the Depression and Bipolar Support Alliance, your local chapters of those will be incredibly helpful and for you supportive as well. Regardless, coercion is not a sustainable way to get somebody help. The best way to get someone help is to get them invested in care. Obviously, if they don't have insight, you've reached a point that's ideally you never get to that point, right? You never let it get that far. And we in this country are dealing with mental health as though every instance is an emergency, and we only will deal with it in the last worst case scenario, unfortunately. But ideally, you want to deal with it as soon as possible. And at that point, you get the person invested in care. So you don't have to resort to things like coercion. But there are times that if somebody is a threat to themselves or others, of course, they need help and they may not know that they need help. And helping them get that help is part of, you know, being a good family member, a good friend. And I recommend and thank the people who do that. And I think it's wonderful. But you have to just keep in mind that coercing someone to get care is a long-term kind of strategy is definitely not going to work. The last thing, I wanted to recommend a book for family members. This is by Dr. Mark Comrat, and he is a psychiatrist at Johns Hopkins. He's wonderful. I've met him a couple times, heard him speak. He's fantastic. Knows what he's talking about. I don't agree with absolutely everything in the book, but I can't think of most books that there's something everything that I agree with in the book, but it's a fantastic resource. I really recommend it. It's called You Need Help by Dr. Mark Comrat. And I am going way over, but I hope you guys have a good week. I hope you keep your questions coming. If you have any more questions in relation to this one, let me know. All right, take care. Bye.